When I first started watching wrestling in April of 2008, all I really did was tune into the programming every week. I watched Raw every Monday, SmackDown every Friday, the occasional ECW on Tuesday nights, and that was pretty much it. I wasn't a full-blown member of the IWC, the Internet Wrestling Community. I mean, nowadays it's just stupid to use that term because everyone's on the internet that's a wrestling fan, but back in the day, no one really worked, no one really looked at the dirt sheets, there was no Facebook. I mean, there was Facebook, but I never used it anyway. There was no Twitter. Again, it was Twitter, but no one really used it by that point in time in terms of the wrestling fan base. So there was really no other way to interact with wrestling fans and figure out the kind of ins and outs of the business for the most part. I wasn't really a part of that. I didn't read the dirt sheets, any of that kind of stuff. I also didn't go to indie shows. I never knew what those were until May of 2009, and you can check out my review, my thoughts on indie wrestling and my indie wrestling experience. Not me indie wrestling, but going to indie wrestling shows. I did a video blog about that back in May if you want to check that out, cheap plug. I also didn't go to any WWE shows or anything like that. I mean, they were in the area a couple times over the course of 08, and I mean, I went to my first WWE show in November of 09, so a year and a half later. But I mean, it really wasn't in the cards at that point in time. I never really had the money to go to a WWE show, so I never did. And I also never knew when wrestlers were coming to town to do appearances and autograph signings and stuff like that. All I did, if you want to call, I mean, I loved wrestling, but I mean, if you want to call me a casual fan, that's basically what I was. Because all I really did was watch Raw, SmackDown, ECW, that was it. But then, to provide a little background here, my dad knows some people who work at Quinnipiac. We go to Quinnipiac basketball games. Anyone who is from the Northeast that's watching this video knows what I'm talking about. Quinnipiac College, and we go to all the basketball games every winter. And we always had season tickets to go, and we still do to this day. I go occasionally when I'm home. But he's friends with some people that worked at the Bridgeport Sound Tigers Arena. Now, again, anyone from Connecticut knows what I'm talking about. If not, that's okay, because you don't really need to anyway. But he would be able to trade the Quinnipiac basketball tickets for some other stuff, you know, like other games at Yale and stuff like that. And we were able to score free tickets to a Sound Tigers hockey game on October 18th, 2008. Now, we only weren't going for just that hockey game. I'm not a big hockey fan. I wasn't even a big basketball fan. I just kind of went with my dad because he would take us along. And at the time, I never really had anything else to do, so why the hell not? But the caveat here was that appearing at this Sound Tigers game in Connecticut, at Bridgeport, Connecticut, at this Sound Tigers hockey game, was then WWE superstar, ECW legend, which I didn't know at the time, Tommy Dreamer. Like I said before, I knew nothing of the original ECW. The only ECW that existed to me at the time was the new ECW, the ECW brand, on Sci-Fi every single week. But I watched Tommy Dreamer every single week. I knew exactly who he was. So when my dad said we'd be able to meet him, he was doing an autograph signing on this at this show, at this event, at this game, I said, absolutely, let's go. It was October 18th from when I filmed this, October 17th, so 6 years ago from tomorrow. It was an absolutely amazing experience, and I mean, I never really knew the date exactly of when it occurred. I mean, I remember the experience like it was yesterday, but although I'm usually great with dates, I never really remembered what exact date it was. I mean, this was 6 years ago, and not a lot was going on in my life at the time, so it really kind of was hard to remember, but it wasn't until just recently that I confirmed that it was October 18th, that Saturday. It was a Saturday afternoon. We left the house early to get to the show nice and early. Now, not only would we be meeting Tommy Dreamer, waiting in line to get his autograph. So in my dad knowing some people that worked the Bridgeport Sound Tigers Arena, he'd be able to take us up, the guy that we knew, that my dad was friends with, he'd be able to take us up to Tommy Dreamer's VIP box at the game and meet him before anyone else, get a personal meet and greet with Tommy Dreamer. It was absolutely surreal. I mean, today if that happened to me to go meet, I don't know, a Zack Ryder, or, I mean, I wasn't even a huge Tommy Dreamer fan, but I'm trying to think of a wrestler on the roster today that comes to mind that I would be like, oh, cool, to go meet, like a Jack Swagger or something, you know what I mean? So it was like one of those kind of things, like, I'd be surreal today, but I mean, I'd be ecstatic today to go meet a wrestler, like, of that stature, and I didn't even know it was ECW legendary status at this point in time, but to even go back then, I mean, this was the first wrestler I ever met, and to have it be done in the fashion that it was, to have it happen the way that it did, like I said before, was absolutely surreal. Not everyone gets to get this kind of experience, so I was extremely fortunate in this instance. So we get to the game, we watch the game for a little bit. I'm just anxiously waiting. Me and my brother are talking about old WWE matches and like shit from earlier on in the year, just kind of shooting the shit about random stuff. And we're waiting, and we're waiting, and we're waiting, and we're waiting, and we're waiting to go meet Tommy Dreamer, and finally it comes. the halftime of the game appears. I mean, that was when he was going to come outside and meet the rest of the fans. But we were going to go meet him before everyone else. So before the halftime approaches, we go up to the box. So we go up this elevator, this exclusive elevator with this guy. And I mean, I'm trying to make, from the way I'm describing it, it sounds like I'm meeting like the fucking president of the United States. But to me, that's what it felt like. Because I was meeting a WWE superstar, not a no-name loser from the indie scene, nothing like that. Not any disrespect to indie wrestlers, but it wasn't like, I mean, I wouldn't meet an indie wrestler about 6 months later, so that's why I bring that up, and I had no idea who this fucking guy was. I think his name was Mikey Batts, and he had a one-off appearance in TNA or something like that, but that, you know, paled in comparison to being able to meet Tommy Dreamer. Like I said before, at the time, he was still employed by WWE. He was on TV every single week. He was feuding with Jack Swagger at the time. Like, this is a great experience for me. So we go up there. I meet him. I'm absolutely starstruck. He's so starstruck at meeting this guy. He was so, so friendly. You know, he's trying to talk to us, kind of, you know, ask us where we're from, if we watch Raw every week, all that kind of stuff. Who's my favorite wrestler? And I said Tommy Dreamer, I mean, jokingly. I mean, at the time, it was William Regal, and I always will be William Regal. But it was just funny when he asked us that, but I mean, I was at a loss for words, and I mean, it was, I can't even describe how great this experience was. I mean, it's really hard to put it into words, but he was, you know, trying to introduce us to each other and stuff like that. I mean, it was just so great. I mean, I was so speechless, and like I am right now, because I can't even describe how amazing the experience was. But I mean, I can't remember every exact detail of what happened, but it was just so great. So we're talking for a little bit. We're watching the game. He's got all these other entourage with him. He's probably had his family with him or something. I didn't recognize him. I mean, back then, I probably would have. I mean, like, if I met him today, I probably would have. But back then, I didn't. So we're just talking to him and whatever. He gave us an autograph. He asked us what both our names were. He gave us an autograph, which I still do, which I still have to this day. I thought I lost it for a while, but I actually found it about 6 or 7 months ago when I got back from college and I was going through all the stuff that was in my room that my mom cleaned out and all this other shit. And that autograph was in there, so I still do have it. I think it said Stay Hardcore, and then it said Graham from Tommy Dreamer, so that was fucking awesome. And then we also got a picture with him, like you can see in the thumbnail of the video, but if you did not see the thumbnail of the video, which you obviously can, so you can go back and watch it, that doesn't make any sense. But anyway, though, I did get that picture framed with Tommy Dreamer, me, which I could look completely different now, obviously. And this is 6 years ago when I was like in eighth grade, and my little brother Jackson right there. So we had this picture framed. My dad got it framed for me for Christmas that year. But like I said before, just a great, 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 great experience just meeting him. So we were there for like 5-10 minutes maybe before he wanted to go down to halftime, during halftime to go meet the rest of the people. So we got to ride down in the elevator with Tommy Dreamer. So the guy that my dad knows, he goes, "So do you want to go back down in the elevator with Tommy Dreamer?" Like, hell fucking yeah, I will. So me and my brother go down there. My dad, I think, had already left. But just to be able to meet him. And I mean, he was also talking about where he was. He was from Yonkers, New York. He's from the area. And he was just so friendly and just so down to earth. It was just amazing. I mean, this isn't no WWE champion or anything, but I mean, at the time, it was such a great experience for me. Like I said before, having not met any wrestlers before this. And it was easily one of the best wrestler interactions I've ever had and probably ever will have, because Tommy Dreamer is so great to all of his fans. And I'll get to why that is in just a second. But we ride down in the elevator with him. His agent's asking us who our favorite wrestler is, and I'm like, Tommy Dreamer? And he's like, you know, laughing and whatever. And when we said goodbye to him, I said, I think I either wanted to say to him, or I did say to him, good luck in your match with Jack Swagger. Because like I said before, at this point in time, October of 2008, he was feuding with the newcomer Jack Swagger, now former World Heavyweight Champion, but, you know, looking back on it now, it's so funny. And I think he kind of laughed and kind of went on with his stuff and went on with his business. And as he went over to the table, fans were like, it's Tommy Dreamer. All the kids are going crazy, going over to sign autographs and stuff like that. I'm already walking down right behind him, with a smile on my face, the picture on my dad's phone. And this was when we still had cell phones. We didn't have cameras or anything. And actually, I think it was. We did get it on a camera. We got it on my dad's cell phone, and we got it on my brother's camera. And we finally found all those pictures. I think I just found them earlier this year, because I told my brother to upload those photos to his laptop, and he never did up until like up a couple months ago. So 5 years later, 5-6 years later, we finally find this photo. So it's amazing. But anyway, you know, as he goes over to the line of people screaming for him, you know, going crazy for Tommy Dreamer, I already have a smile on my face, smile on my face, autograph in hand. So happy to have met Tommy Dreamer. It was such a great experience. But that wasn't all. That was the first time I met Tommy Dreamer. I would go on to meet him another three more times. Fast forward a year and a half later, Northeast Wrestling. I've mentioned a number of times here on the channel before. And now he's a regular at these shows, and he would kind of start being a regular in 2010, 2011. So he would be appearing at one of these shows also alongside Booker T and Dusty Rhodes and all these other people. But I wanted to meet Tommy Dreamer again. So we definitely did. And I have the picture, but the picture broke. I mean, I hung it up on my wall last year up here in the dorm. But when I was bringing it up this year to hang it up, it actually broke. And all the packaging and whatever, that kind of sucked. But I do have a picture of when we met him the second time. And the best part about Tommy Dreamer, and I'll get to, like I said before, I'll get to why he's so great to his fans in just a second, is that when we met him the second time, we, you know, offered to buy for a picture to get with him again, but he was like, no, I'll give it to you for free. And every single time I've met him since, he's always given us something for free because we know him, my brother and myself. And he knew my dad. I'm like, he recognized me too. That's the thing too. When you meet wrestlers and whatever, I mean, they see so many, you know, hundreds of thousands of people on a regular basis. And he was in WWE at the time. This isn't like some indie wrestler or whatever. This is a guy that sees so many faces all the time. And the fact that he recognized me, he remembered my name, he remembered that my dad knew someone from the Bridgeport Sound Tigers Arena. He remembered that experience. And this was a year and a half later. It wasn't like it was a month later, a year and a half later. So it was crazy. And he remembered that. We got a picture with him. We were on our way. That was pretty awesome. We would meet him again about 6 months later at another Northeast Wrestling show, I believe in Waterbury, Connecticut. We got another free picture. I didn't get a picture with him that time. I got an autograph on my replica ECW title belt. Not like it was a Jack specific belt. It was the silver belt too. I actually had the old ECW belt, but I wanted them to sign the new ECW belt. So that was pretty cool. Again, meeting him. He remembered me. And for the fourth and final time, as of right now, I mean, it's been 3 years since I last saw him. I haven't gone to much indie wrestling since then. But I got to meet him again at a show I went to in December of 2011, a show that also had Mick Foley at it, which I'll talk about in a later video blog, probably around December when, you know, the anniversary comes around. But again, he recognized me, gave me a free... I don't think he gave me a free photo. We didn't get a photo with him that time. I did get a video with Tommy Dreamer that night. And you can actually see up here on the channel was one of the very first videos I uploaded back in 2011. And I think it says Tommy Dreamer interview for WrestleRant. I had it on my channel as my channel trailer for the longest time before finally changing it earlier this year. But that was also a surreal experience to be able to interview Tommy Dreamer. I mean, it was a casual interview. It wasn't a formal interview or anything like that. Like, in the video, if you watch it, my brother filmed it with my phone, so it's not the greatest quality in the world. But he would give me that interview. He would ask me how old I was, you know, picking up chicks and all this kind of other stuff. It was really, really funny. Like I said before, you can watch that interview right here on the channel, thus confirming that we are indeed friends. So if you take this all for bullshit and that none of this happened... He basically confirms in that interview that we are indeed friends, so you can go back and watch that. And he also signed my legend, the Rise and Fall of ECW book, which I do not have with me here at the moment. But, you know, he took flattery to that, considering the fact that he played a big part in writing that book when it came out in, I think, 2009, 2010. So to have him sign that was also very cool. And like I said, that was the last time that I met him in person. I've talked to him over Twitter a few times. In 2010, I believe. I mean, I wasn't all that active on Twitter at the time. I messaged him on Twitter saying, hey, do you remember me? He said, yes, I do, from that show. Do you have a picture? And I did not have a picture, but I did. He did DM me, so that was pretty cool. 2011, I said, do you remember me? It's my birthday today. Would it be cool if I got a birthday shout-out? He said, yes, I do remember. Happy birthday. That was pretty cool. 2012, same thing. Not for my birthday, but in October, I was reminiscing on the anniversary of the event, and he DM'd me saying that... he did remember, he liked the photo, he remembered the experience, he said, hope all is well with you. So again, that was really awesome. It's all through DMs and whatever. So he's DM'd me three times, I've met him in person four times, and I'm hoping to go to an indie event where he's at one of these days so I can be able to, you know, shoot the shit and kind of catch up with him. That'd be pretty sweet. But why is he so awesome to his fans? I said this before a couple of times. And it wasn't until, I mean, he was such a great guy in general. Tommy Dreamer is one of the nicest guys, one of the biggest wrestling fans in the business, that is a genuine wrestling fan, loves the business. That's how awesome he is. But it wasn't until that I listened to his podcast, his interview with Stone Cold Steve Austin and Austin's podcast. in, I believe, July, where Tommy Dreamer's talking about how an experience that he had with Bob Backlund changed his life forever, and that Bob Backlund didn't really recognize him, he didn't really acknowledge him, and Tommy Dreamer was heartbroken that he never really got to meet Bob Backlund that night when he was a little kid, and he would obviously meet him again years later, and you know they would laugh about it now, but Tommy Dreamer said that from that point forward, if he were to ever become famous, ever to become a wrestler, he would treat every single fan with respect and remember every single one of them and give each of them an autograph, a photo, whatever. So that really put it all into perspective to me. For me, that not a lot of wrestlers have that mindset. A lot of people say, yeah, we didn't get to you, fuck off, you know, whatever. Tommy Dreamer takes time to sign every single autograph, take every single picture. If someone recognizes him, he will take a picture with them in the street. He's that nice of a guy. And I loved his YouTube show, but I mean, this is, you know, a bit random, and this is kind of branching off and digressing, but he had a YouTube show right here on YouTube. He had his own channel for a while, Tommy Dreamer TV. It was Hardcore TV, I think is what he called it, which was really, really entertaining if you want to go back and watch that. The Halloween episode, which I usually watch on Halloween every year, was absolutely awesome. Really enjoy watching that again. But anyway, being able to meet Tommy Dreamer, like I said before, I hate to sound like a broken record, was an absolutely amazing experience. Like I said before, one of the nicest and most genuine guys, wrestlers that you can ever meet. And if you ever get the chance, and it's always likely too, because he's always doing indie events, usually up here in the Northeast area, but sometimes elsewhere in the United States and overseas and stuff like that. He runs the House of Hardcore and, you know, that kind of stuff, so definitely check out that. But to be able to meet him when I first met him 6 years ago, and it's amazing to think that it was that long ago, 6 years ago from this weekend, October 18th, 2008, will forever stand in my mind as the single greatest interaction I've ever had with a wrestler.